Or Quinn.
Mr. Speaker. Papaki goa ngā wai o tamoana nui a toi, mai ngā kuri, whare ki tihirau, tuunga mai o mātou. Mai hoki e makatū ki Tongariro, te tauranga mai o Te Aroa, ti hei Māori ora. Ki ngā tini mate o te wā, kua mene ki te pō, haere, haere oki oki atu. Tātou ngā kānui ora o rātou mā, tēnā anō tātou katoa. Tēnā koutou, te ati awa, e manaaki nei, ia mātou. Kei te hau kāinga, e takahi māmoe mai ki te tōtoko, ia hau I te rangi nei, tēnā koutou. He uri o mātātua o Te Aroa, mea airani, e mihi atu nei, Ko au te mātā mua o te haupō, te timana tuatahi o te runanga o Ngāti Awa, nō reira tēnā koe e tamana whakawā o tēnā rā tātou koutou e te whare kia ora.
Waters crash upon the shores of the Bay of Plenty from the dogs of whare at Katikati across to Tihirau, the landing place of Mātātua. From Maketū to Tongariro, also the anchorage of Te Aroa. Tis the sneeze of life. To the many deaths of the day who have passed on, farewell, depart, rest in eternal peace. To those of us living descendants of departed ones, greetings once again to all of us. Greetings to you, Te Atiawa, for your hospitality. To the people from home who have travelled from afar to support me today, my acknowledgements. I am a descendant of Mātātua, Te Aroa and Ireland, extending greetings, and I am the eldest son of Te Hau Paul, the first chairman of the Runanga of Ngāti Awa. And so greetings to you, Mr. Speaker, and to the House. Greetings.
Mr. Speaker, firstly, let me offer my congratulations. Your elevation to the highest office in this House is a testament to your long and distinguished public service that you have given. I want to also congratulate my fellow inductees on both sides of the House. We join experienced and wise counsel as we start to share in the mantle of responsibility for overseeing the country's affairs. In accepting that challenge, we each have a valuable contribution to make. But in my view, what is really important is that we remind ourselves daily of what that value proposition is. I want to return to that theme a little later, but for now, let me say, politics was furthest from my mind in my formative years, so much so that I had no concept of our country's democratic processes until my mid-teens, and only then because for about a three-week period prior to an election, there seemed much to do about nothing, following which everything appeared to return to normal. In many ways, my life has trodden a familiar path, rooted in the traditions of a Catholic rural upbringing, exposed to the idealisms of university life, and a career that has traversed in the early years the public sector, and for a much longer period thereafter, one that has been roughed up by the realities of the commercial and voluntary sectors. Throughout, I have been driven by the mantra of standing up for what I believe in, whether it be as a committee member of the Marist St Pat's Rugby Club, because I believe sport and recreation is just one of many ways for our youth to start achieving their potential, or as a servant of Ngāti Awa, resolving a treaty claim. The reason I now stand in this House before you, Mr Speaker, is not because I have had an ambition to be a Member of Parliament, but because I became increasingly concerned at the direction the last administration was taking this country. I believe there are two primary functions to being a Member of Parliament, both of equal importance. The first is to represent the people of New Zealand, and in the case of a constituent MP, a Member of Parliament, that manifests itself in representing one's electorate and the citizens within that electorate. The decisions this House makes affect the ordinary lives of every person and every electorate, and it is something we must never lose sight of. Speaking of electorate, I would welcome the opportunity of working through the issues confronting herself with that electorate's Member of Parliament. Now that he has me to turn to, Hutsouth is likely to be able to reverse the declining socio-economic indicators that have been occurring in that electorate for some time. The issues confronting residents in Hutsouth are the same as those facing all electorates.
No interjection. Our point of order, Prime Minister John Key.
Look, I'm sorry to interrupt the member's speech. There's a long-standing convention that members' maiden speeches are not interrupted, and members can take it on the chin from time to time if a member wants to make a comment. If Mr Mallard can't control himself, I suggest that Mr Mallard goes back to his office.
I don't need any assistance, please, sir. I did chastise the member that it is a long-held tradition. There will be no interjections. Point of order, Trevor Mallard.
Mr Speaker, it is not a long-term tradition. There have been points of order on many occasions on maiden speeches, and they occur on the occasions when individuals breach their responsibility to be non-controversial. That member did then.
Just a moment. Certainly it has been my experience in this House, which goes back to 1993. It's the first experience I've had of it. I'd ask the member to contain himself. Paul Quinn.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. The issues confronting residents in Hutsouth are the same as those facing all electorates, a desperate lack of frontline services. In Hutsouth, that translates into 3,000 residents not having their own doctor because of the GP shortage. Violent crime on the increase, businesses closing and unemployment rising. I have no doubt the policies this government campaigned on to address these and other challenges facing the country are the right ones. The second primary role members of Parliament have, I believe, is to provide leadership necessary to ensure New Zealand once again is acknowledged as a preeminent member of the world community. Bookend comments attributable to a very senior member of the previous administration, both made within the precincts of this building, to me encapsulate everything that was wrong with their oversight of the country. The first, made in August 2000, with the words, "We won, you lost, eat that." This sneering comment set a reference point for what was to prove a downward spiralling series of behaviours that oozed negativity and did not engender the leadership necessary to capitalise on years of economic opportunity. The other bookend comment, made as the country was winding up in readiness for this year's election, were the words to the effect, "The election was a fight for power." A fight for power is a fight for control, which in turn is a fight to have command over our lives. It is what ordinary New Zealanders refer to as the nanny state, and the annals of history will record the people rejected that style of administration at the ballot box this year. Instead, the people of New Zealand have opted for the National Party leadership model, one based on a value set that provides equal opportunity for all, projects individual freedoms, embraces choice, encourages innovation and enterprise, inspires aspiration. Everyone is encouraged to achieve their potential. That is why I am proud to stand today as part of a national government and acknowledge the already outstanding leadership of our Prime Minister, and I look forward to contributing under his leadership to the team effort. That team effort includes a partnership with the Māori Party, a partnership that I welcome. Ngā rangatira, tēnā koutou, ke te mihi ki a koutou. There has been hysterical denunciation of this partnership in some quarters. This denunciation is an affront to the freedom of choice, as have been the accusations levelled at the Māori Party last week by the opposition during the passage of the taxation bill through its various stages. They accuse the Māori Party of selling Māori short when under their watch the average Māori income of Māori has gone from being 84% of what Pākehā earn to 77%. The fact speaks for themselves. Under the previous administration, most of the Māori socio-economic indicators have deteriorated. No wonder closing the gaps disappeared from the vernacular.
That's
For some time now, I have publicly stated my view that the Māori Party is a natural coalition partner for the Māori Party. Why? Because our value sets are aligned. We are both fiercely protective of property rights. We are both focused on aspirational pathways. We are both determined to provide a framework whereby everyone has an equal opportunity to achieve their potential. All the paradigm advances that have occurred in moving Māori forward during this country's short history have, in my view, occurred under a national government. Set up Aparanga Ngāti's land reforms, introduction of Wānanga, Kohanga Reo, Te Māngai Pāhau, the Māori Television Trust, the fisheries settlement, the first Raupatu settlement, and subsequent treaty settlement processes driven by a national government. I welcome the Māori Party as a team member in this government and look forward to working with them in advancing the cause of Māoridom. Kia kaha. Of particular interest to me in this regard is expediting treaty settlement processes. It is but one specific reason why I now stand in this House. It is my response to the total lack of leadership provided by the previous administration in getting on with the job, particularly when it was obvious there was a better way. I note that they magically found that better way some 6 months out from an election. Another concern is getting the Crown to abide by the commitment to partnership set out in treaty settlements, once those settlements have been agreed. By way of example, Ngāti Awa has had to go to the High Court and Court of Appeal to demonstrate the words in their deed of settlement, finally executed in April 2005, mean what they say. You would think after four comprehensive defeats and no victories, the message might have got through, particularly given some of the findings of the judgments. Sadly, not. I look forward to the leadership my friend and colleague, the Honourable Chris Finlayson, will bring to this portfolio in ensuring enduring settlements are expedited in the spirit of partnership. Mr. Speaker, I now want to return to value proposition. This government has committed itself to going for growth, in the knowledge that only through real economic growth will our country once again be able to provide the aspirational pathways that improve the lives of every New Zealander. The great moments of history were achieved against a simple but focused vision. Abraham Lincoln set out to abolish slavery and unite a country. John F. Kennedy challenged his country to send a man to the moon before the decade of the 70s arrived. Bill Gates took the computer to the home. Of course, we have our own icons to look up to. Lord Rutherford and Sir Edmund Hillary are but two. A third was Sir Peter Blake and Team New Zealand, who benchmarked everything they did against one simple test. Will it make the boat go faster? Our partnership with another of our team members, the ACT Party, calls for the closing of the income gap with our near neighbours by 2025. It is a laudable goal, but what happens if Australia slips back or we pass them by 2015? Whatever we agree on, we need to be ready to respond to the challenges of the world. That will take dynamism, energy and enthusiasm, and a fair degree of business smarts. That is what today's modern National Party brings to New Zealand at this critical time. There is one other very important member of our government team that must be acknowledged, and that is the public service. For it is they who helped the government do its work. I have no doubt under this government, the manner of a neutral public service will be restored so that they can, in complete confidence, give free and frank advice. My one reservation is that at times there can be a silo mentality adopted by some departments. We must move past this by bringing greater cohesion and have all departments each day challenge themselves with the question, how are we contributing to growth today? I am proud of that, to be part of a government that is going for growth. Everything I do as a member of this House will be benchmarked against this, and everything we do in this House should strive for the same. That is what this government's leadership is focused on, and that is what must drive the public service. Our guardianship of this country is, in relative terms, for a short time. Our responsibility is to leave it a better place for those that follow. My arrival in this House is not the end of a journey, but the beginning of a challenge. Mr. Speaker, in concluding, I have already acknowledged Ngāti Awa and family and the support for me. I take the opportunity to acknowledge the National Party and its Wellington Metro branches, but in particular its President Judy Kirk, who has encouraged and cajoled me in moments of doubt. I also take this opportunity to have my record my indebtedness to certain other people. Ursula Quinn, Sisters of Compassion, Teresa Pimpley, Peter McCall, Rosa Bernard Grant, Roland O'Regan, Regent Geraldine Power. Without their care and support, I would not be standing here tonight. But most of all, I would like to thank my wife, Viv, who, while initially a reluctant participant, was nonetheless being prepared to put her own outstanding career on hold and unselfishly support and allow me to pursue what I believe in. You are my beloved, my confidence, and my conscience, and I say thank you. Nō reira. Te ara koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa, ka huri.
Tina, Tina, Tina.